أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم ويحفظوا فروجهم ذلك أزكى لهم إن الله خبير بما يصنعون وقل للمؤمنات يغضضن من أبصارهن ويحفظن فروجهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا ما ظهر منها وليضربن بخمرهن على جيوبهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا لبعولتهن صدق الله العلي العظيم Every night we discuss one of the subjects that touches our life. And it could be sometimes controversial. People ask about it regularly. And one of these subjects that we decided to discuss tonight on the 11th of the month of Ramadan is the concept or the issue of hijab. Because many people ask, is hijab really relevant nowadays? We live in the 21st century, we live in, you know, contemporary time, in advanced societies, where these societies, they advocate equality between men and women. So is it really relevant? Is it necessary? You don't think it's something of the past, something outdated? Women today, they should not do it. Maybe back home in countries like such and such, they still need it. But why do we need it in Europe? Why do we need it in America? So many people ask these questions. And some of them, they believe that hijab, Muslims and non-Muslims, they believe that hijab is degrading. It's a form of disrespect and demeaning to women. They think that hijab, when you ask women to wear hijab, this is some sort of backwardness. You are shutting her off the society. You are not doing justice to her. A form of oppression. On the other hand, some people think, no, this is not a form of oppression. This is something good for her, for the society at large, for men, for the family. And there is nothing wrong in that. Hijab, they believe that hijab is a form of protection. It's a form of moral, ethical defense and protection for women in this society. So there is a long debate, and this debate is continuing. We have this debate every single day. Every single day people ask, why hijab? Why should Muslim women observe hijab? We do have this question. We have some scholars who came out, not classical or traditional scholars from seminaries, but probably university professors, intellectuals, who believe that hijab is not mandated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's nowhere. It's nowhere in the Quran. I remember one time a lady came to me and she said, nowhere the Quran says, mentions hijab. But this is not the case. This is not the case. Let's discuss this over a few minutes and see why hijab is important and whether hijab is really mandated by God or it's a man-made verdict. First of all, hijab has been mentioned in the Quran in four different places with four different terms. Four different terms. All these terms, they have the same meaning, the same connotation. Number one, the verse that I earlier recited a few minutes ago in Surah An-Nur. Surah An-Nur is chapter 24. And the verse is verse number 31. 30 and 31. The verse speaks about khimar, And the wording of the verse, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلِيَضْرِبْنَ. يَضْرِبْنَ, in this terminology here, in this context, it means they cast down. They cast down, or they cover. وَلِيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرْهِنَّ. خُمُر is not خَمْرَهَا. Don't get confused. Khumur is the plural of khimar, and khimar is the veil or the cover. The general meaning of khimar is a veil or the cover or the hijab or the piece of the cloth that is usually used by women. This is the meaning of khimar in the Arabic grammar or Arabic literature. This is one. And then hijab has been mentioned in chapter 33, Surah Al-Ahzab, in three different verses. And the wording of it, one time is jilbab. Ya ayyuhan nabi. This is chapter 33. Ya ayyuhan nabi. Qul li nisa'ik. Qul li azwajika wa banatika. Wa nisa'il mu'minina yudnina alayhinna min jalabi bihin. O Prophet, say to your wives, to your daughters, and to the women of the Muslim community, of your community, yudnina alayhim. Again, they cast down, they cover, they cast down. Min jalabi bihin. And the jilbab is again another meaning for hijab. Jilbab is the one that covers the whole body. That's the second place. The third place, again, is mentioned in the Quran by the name of hijab itself. In chapter 33, وَإِذَا سَأَلْتُمُهُنَّ مَتَاعًا فَاسْأَلُوهُنَّ مِنْ وَرَائِي حِجَاب, which means the veil or the partition or things like that. And number four again, Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter 33, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. Do not display your ornament, your bodies, your physical structure. Do not display it. Do not uncover it. Tabarruj means when someone uncovers something which is covered. When you uncover it, this is the process of tabarruj. Wala tabarruj. Don't do things that women of the time of ignorance used to do. Either they uncover part of their bodies, or sometimes they go naked completely. Neither partially nor completely do not uncover yourself. So, the females. وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا. Because here's تَبَرَّجْنَا, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing women here. Now, there are certain objections here. Some women say, why should we pay the price? If men are bad, they should behave themselves. You should speak to men to change their attitude, to have more respect for females in the society, to have more self-control, let them control their desires, let them control their urges, why they act like animals. So why should we pay the price? Why should we cover? Because there are certain men, you know, at large in the society who have bad, who have bad intention, why should we pay the price? This is one objection. This is one question that we hear it, you know, oftentimes from women and some men, of course. The second, I'll come to this point. The second objection or a point that some people, you know, they bring about is that hijab is something of the past. Hijab does not work for modern societies. For societies who respect women, in societies where women have an almost equal place with men, then you should not mention hijab. Hijab, something of the past, something which is, you know, a sign of backwardness. It's not a sign of development. It's not a sign of advancement. So let's stay away from the hijab, and we don't need hijab. Our women here, they observe their religious and moral duties, and there is no need for the hijab. This is another discussion, that the hijab is something of the past. We should not bring it to the future. Leave it in the past. Leave it in societies that are mostly traditional, and most of them are a patriarch society where men dominate the family and the society, and they want to control women. And one of the ways to control women is through imposing hijab on them. So this is the second argument. The third argument, or the third objection, is that, is that even women who observe hijab, even those who observe hijab, sometimes they commit sin. And the hijab does not deter them from being bad, from acting bad, from committing sometimes shameful acts, immoral acts. And they give you examples. They say, see, look at this, look at that, look at this family, this lady. They wear hijab, but they are still doing bad things. So this means hijab is not good. Why do you advocate hijab? These are three important objections. If you have any other objection, let's listen to it now. Yeah, before we begin the rebuttal. Now, I understand the first one, men have to control themselves, very true. And this is why Allah begins with men. When He speaks about hijab, what does He say in Surah An-Nur? قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ O Prophet, He begins with men. Before going to women, He says it is the responsibility of men to cast down their eyes. يَغُضُّوا الْغَضُّ هُوَ التَّقْلِيل To decrease. Allah did not say let them shut out their eyes. Because if you shut your eyes, you can't walk, you can't see. He says let them decrease. Let them not gaze. This is the right interpretation. They should not gaze at women. You may look at them, you may talk to them, but don't gaze with bad intention. So this is how it begins. Allah is addressing men here. Very true that. We have to speak to men before women. Because the issue of hijab is not a piece of cloth. It's an issue of dignity. And chastity, iffah, and protection. And that does not, women alone do not shoulder this responsibility. It's men and women. And it is men before women. It is men before women. Men are the, you know, they begin the family, they initiate the family, they are the pioneers. They establish the family. So Allah begins by addressing men, He says, you have to be extra careful. You have to be extra careful. Whether all women, they wear hijab, they observe it or they don't. Your responsibility is not to look. It's to respect yourself. And consider the way you treat women, the way you want people to treat your wife, your daughter, your sister, your mother. Treat them in the same way. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ They cast down their eyes, and then وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ private parts, that part, the part that I spoke about last night, the sexuality, which is very important. We cannot deny this. Can someone deny this? Over dinner we were talking with some friends. One of the scholars would say that sexuality is more important than food and a drink. And this is true. This is true. For some people, this is more important. The pressure that sexuality has on us is sometimes more than thirst or hunger. So you have to find a solution. You have to find a solution. If we do not find a solution, we're going to turn into what? Animals. Animals know no boundaries. They don't have any boundaries. But with the human beings, what makes us human beings, the boundaries, the rules and the boundaries, the discipline that we have. If we give in to our desires, to our shahwa, to our desires, to our urges, to our temptations, then we're not going to be human beings anymore. What makes a human and distinguishes him from animals is the power to control. Animals do not have power to control. Animals, when they are hungry, whatever food they see, they jump on that food. They don't ask, is this food for me, for someone else? Did I pay for it? They don't ask. Hungry. With us, we have to go through this process, mental process. Is this food for me or not? Yes, I am hungry. But at the same time, I have to make sure that this food is lawful for me. The same thing with other concepts. So Allah begins with man. Very right. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ. The Quran uses the term tazkiyah. If they want to purify themselves, if they want to be morally and spiritually stronger, then they have to control. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. غضوا أبصاركم ترون العجائب. It begins with your eyes. If you are able to control your eyes, God is going to allow you to see some miracles, some mysteries in this universe. Mysteries are there, but we don't see them. Why? Because the vision is weak. Why the vision is weak? Because the heart is weak. There's a weakness here. When the heart is weak, then the vision does not work. غضوا أبصاركم. Cast down your eyes, control them. ترون العجائب. You're going to see mysteries of this universe. وكذلك نري إبراهيم ملكوت السماوات والأرض. Why Ibrahim was able to see mysteries? Because he was able to control. He has the power of control. He would discipline himself. Self-control. This is the point. This is the main goal of fasting. كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Taqwa is control. The simple meaning of taqwa is to control our desires. So this is point number one. We agree that men have to act in a civil way, in an ethical way. They should not take advantage of women. Whether women, they want to put on their clothes or go naked. Your responsibility as a mu'min, as a believer, you have, imagine someone, I'll give you an example. Someone, he leaves his, let's say, iPhone here, and he goes. Someone who has iman, someone who does not have iman, he will go and get it. He will take it. He will consider it a ghanima, gain, or a profit. He will take it away. But someone with iman will say, no, listen, this one has an honor. Has an honor. It is true that he forgot his wallet, his phone here. He made a mistake. I should not make a mistake. I should not make a mistake. This is a humanity. This is taqwa. Taqwa is not we take advantage of someone who made a mistake and we go and make a double mistake. Taqwa means when someone makes a mistake, we have to correct it. So this is number one. Yes, we agree that men have to have more control. Second, when they say that hijab is a deterrence, a hindrance. When she wears hijab, she cannot integrate herself into the society. This is like locking her down, handcuffing her, not giving her freedom. But this is not true, my friends. And I have many examples. Many, many examples that you know them and we know them. That hijab was never a hindrance. Yes, I agree with you. It is difficult. It is extremely difficult to observe hijab in the United States of America. Extremely difficult. It's not easy. Probably it's women's biggest jihad and biggest struggle is to observe hijab, especially a working woman. But still, we have women here in America, in Europe. Many of them, I personally know many university professors, female university professors in the United States of America, who wear hijab, full hijab. They go to the classroom, they've been teaching. Their students, they like them, they are very open with the students. I've been to some of their classes, and I've seen how the students, they discuss the hijab with the female professor. And she defends the hijab. And they respect her more. They respect her more. We have physicians, doctors, who observe the hijab. We have engineers. We have people who work for the government. We have a lady who works in the White House in America. She observes hijab. We have many staffers in the Congress in Washington who observe hijab. Hijab is not a hindrance. If you have the faith here, if you have a strong faith here, and if you are well connected with Allah, you can wear anything and you don't worry about what people say. But sometimes when there is some weakness, we start hesitating, we get confused, we don't have self-confidence. I know of a judge in America, a female judge, who started wearing the hijab 5 years ago. And she told me personally, she said, I struggled. For so many years I've been a practicing Muslim, and I've been a judge, and I was meditating on hijab, reflecting, contemplating, but I did not have the courage. I did not have the courage. One day, it was close to the month of Ramadan, and I fast, I observe fasting and prayers and dua, and she has been to Hajj. She comes from a very good family. And she has the support of her family, and most importantly, the support of her husband, who is a surgeon. The husband is a doctor and a surgeon. He supported her, 100%. She said, when I had the support of my husband, he said to me, go for it, don't worry. Don't worry. You are building this beautiful relationship with God. Why do you worry about people? As long as God is supporting you and with you. She said, the night I decided to go to the court the following day, I could not sleep that night. I was still hesitant what people would say when I show up the following day, following morning, in the court. People who work with me, the staff who work in the court, what would they say? So she said, I could not sleep the whole night. But in the morning I said, I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawakkaltu ala Allah. Put my full trust, I put on the hijab, and I went. Some people thought that, you know, I had cancer, I have cancer treatment, you know, so I lost my hair. This is why I'm covering my hair. Some people thought that there's a new Halloween, you know, I'm putting, you know, some sort of, you know, whatever. And some people realized, no, I'm a Muslim. This is a hijab. And I was explaining to them. She said, I left my car in the parking lot. As I was walking to the courthouse, people started greeting me and asking me, what is it? Some of them are my close friends. And I explained to them, this is my religious duty. Hijab is mandated by God, and I want to obey God and listen to God. And she's very happy about it, until now, until today. She's very happy about her hijab and her job. As an American judge sitting on the bench, she says many of the people who come to the court, they respect me. They respect me for my, you know, standing up and observing my religious duties. So it happens. It is never a hindrance. Yes, it is difficult. I agree with you. To be fair, it's very difficult. At the school, high school, college, university, very difficult, especially during summertime. During summertime, I asked some of the men to try to wear hijab one day and go to work. It's very difficult. But when we fall in love with God, nothing is difficult. Islam is about sacrifice. And I always say, sometimes maybe Allah would not look at women's prayers or fasting, or He says, these are what I look at, your hijab. Hijab at a very difficult time in a difficult country. In a country that does not sympathize with you. In a country that puts you down, you did wear the hijab. You did observe the hijab. Good job. It requires a lot of iman, a lot of self-confidence. And we build this self-confidence during the month of Ramadan. During the month of Ramadan. This is the month. The reason for these long hours of fasting is to build self-confidence and self-control. And beside your husband's, your father's, your brothers should be supportive of you. We men, we should really encourage them and facilitate this process for them. And for certain girls who do not still understand it, it does not make sense, it takes some time. Don't go harsh on them. Don't go hard on them. Try to understand. Give them some time. Let them love the hijab. Let them wear the hijab out of conviction, not out of passion. Out of passion is not good. When we pray out of passion, when we fast out of passion or emotions, it's not good. It's not going to serve us. It's not going to be fruitful. But when someone believes in this concept, believes that fasting is good for my heart and my soul and my mind, then he's going to go after it. You don't need to encourage him anymore. Let them understand the value of hijab. This is number two. And number three, many sisters, they say, I don't believe in hijab because I see many women who wear hijab, they don't behave well. They are not good Muslims. Maybe some of them, yes. We are not saying that every single female who observes hijab, she becomes an angel. No, some of them are not angels. Some of them are angels, alhamdulillah. But some of them are not. Neither all men are angels. These are ibadat. Ibadats are like medicine prescribed by doctors. Sometimes these medicines, if we know how to use them, we use them wisely, then they work. Sometimes the medicine does not work. I'll give you an example. Islam is a package. Islam is not just one or two items. We pick and choose. I pick and choose salat because I can do salat. And sawm, fasting, I can do fasting. But zakat, no, I don't pay zakat. Doesn't work for me. I don't believe in zakat. Islam is a package. It's not pick and choose. Each ibadah integrates the other one. They work together. If one part is missing, the whole machine would not work. So either you do the whole thing, or you don't do it. If someone, let me ask you this question. To maintain good health, what should we do to have a good health? Number one, good diet, yes, good diet. Number two, exercise. Number three, pay your taxes, maybe. Then if someone he has good exercise, good diet, his diet is perfect. Have you seen some people, when they are about to eat or drink, first they start reading here. Oh, this is calories, this, okay, I can do this. No, I can't do that. This is how some people are obsessed, you know. If someone follows very strict diet, good exercise, but then he smokes, would he have a good health? He wouldn't. He cannot go and say, but my exercise is good. I exercise every day. And my diet is perfect. They tell him, but you also smoke. So it's a package. The same thing with hijab, the same thing with zakat, the same thing with hajj, the same thing with being dutiful to your parents, being a good husband, being a good wife, being a good citizen. It's all the same. If something is missing, someone who does all his prayers. Now we have some Muslims who never miss any prayers in Jama'ah. If you see them, especially in some Muslim countries, they never miss any salat. And after the salat, they have nawafil, and after the nawafil, they have taraweeh, and after taraweeh, whatever. But then when they go to the market, they put Islam in the masjid. In the market, they are not Muslims. Islam is absent from the marketplace. Islam is absent from the family. This is not an Islam. They are not going to benefit. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُّ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا يَحُضُّ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ Woe to those who pray but they don't pay attention to the meaning of the prayers, to the results of the prayers. Woe to them. They are losers. They lose. They do not adhere to the message of the prayers, of the salat. They lose. So, yes, I know some, unfortunately, women, they put on the hijab, but they don't adhere to the message of hijab. Hijab has two parts. One is called hijab, piece of a cloth. Piece of a cloth. In some countries, they call it abaya. In others, they call it chador. In other countries, they call it whatever. It's a piece of a cloth. But this is only one part of the hijab. Actually, this is the smaller part of the hijab. The greater part of the hijab is the attitude, is the behavior, is the manners, how you carry yourself. The real hijab is iffa, chastity. Do not cheapen yourself. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, فَلَا يَخْضَعْنَ فِي الْقَوْلِ فَيَطْمَعُ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. Do not be complacent. When you speak, do not cheapen yourself. When you speak with someone stranger, keep your honor. Protect your honor. Do not make yourself available. Don't. Because any concession you give, if someone is sick, is going to take advantage of you. This is why in Islam, Islam advises us, advises women, أن تترفع على الرجال. لا تتكبر وإنما تترفع. There is a difference. Not to be arrogant when she deals with men, with strangers, no. But to keep herself above, at a high altitude. When she speaks with a stranger, she does not bring herself down. Because once she brings herself down, if he's sick, if something wrong with him, with his aql, he's aqlless, without aql, brainless, he's going to take advantage of her. فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ. Allah says, be careful when you speak to strangers. فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. Some people are okay, they understand you, they appreciate you, but some, they don't understand, they take advantage of you. True, hijab is a behavior. Before it is a piece of the cloth, it's a behavior. Let me say one thing to our daughters who are still hesitant. Many of them, many of our daughters, they observe good prayers, good fasting, good manners, good relationship with their parents, with their families. They do good at school, they do good at home, but they are still having a problem with hijab because they go to school, American school. And now you know the image of Islam nowadays, you know. It's declining rather than, you know, we work on improving the image of Islam. Unfortunately, you work 10 years to improve, all of a sudden one incident that takes place here in this state and that state, a bombing, this or that, brings Islam down again. And you have to struggle for another 10, 20 years to work. So I don't blame them. But what I say to those who are still hesitant, I say, I'm not asking you to obey your father. Neither obey your husband on this. Obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take up the hijab as an obedience, submission to the will of God. since you know for certain that God is mandating this in the Quran. And earlier I mentioned four places in the Quran with four different terms. Allah speaks about hijab. So submit to Him. Submit to Him. And you will see the reward in your life. You will see the result. You will see how submitting oneself to the will of God will produce good, positive result in your life. Submit to Allah. And you will see the result over the time. I'm not saying that today you wear hijab and you wake up tomorrow you are an angel. No, that does not happen. But you will see in the long run, you will see the positive result, inshallah, and the fruits of hijab in your life and also in your family's life and in your community. Allahumma khur lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat tabi'a allahumma baynana wa baynahum bil khayrat innaka mujibud da'wat.